Mr. Tracy, can somebody shut that door for us in the back?
Yeah, you lock it. Go ahead. That's fine. Good morning. I got everybody quiet there for a minute, wasn't it? People are still coming in with you. We gotta let them in. They drove all this way. We are glad y'all are with us this morning. We are going to start off this morning when we all get to heaven. Y'all will stand with me. Page 514.
Thank you. seated. Y'all didn't see everybody behind you had already sat down. It's good to be in the Lord's house this morning. If you're glad to be here, say amen.
Amen.
Amen. We're glad to see you here. Visitors, thank you for coming and being a part of this service. We thank you so much for being here and joining with us. I would like to ask you something that I don't say often enough. Fill out one of these visitors' cards in your bulletin, tear it off, and when you go out, give it to a deacon. They'll put $100 with it and drop it in the offering plate. Amen? That's how we get the bills paid around here. So, no, you if you drop it in that basket walking out the door, we'd appreciate it to have a record of your visit. We thank you for coming and for being a part of this service. We're excited about what the Lord's doing. This is a big day for our church, always is. We didn't get to do it in full, you know, like we wanted to last year. And so we are fall festival in this evening. We're going to have church this morning. But we're going to have that fall festival this evening. We're looking forward to that. So let me give you a few announcements, and then we'll go on with the service. A couple of things that are not in the bulletin that I want to share with you. One is we've got a new play set that we're going to be putting together this Saturday. So any men that would like to show up, the Swing Set Building Committee at 10 o'clock Saturday morning is going to meet out here. So go kill you a deer Saturday morning and then come out here and help us put that swing set together. And I'm going to test it out. If it'll hold me, all the kids will be safe. Amen. And so that's actually what happened to the last one. So we're stepping it up. Amen. So anyway, yeah, I'm back. All right. He stuffed me last time. It feels good. Anyway, all right, so we're going to do that next Saturday. November the 6th, 10 o'clock Saturday morning. So come for that if you can and help us put that swing set together. Monday night, men's Bible study. Please join us on that. Men, if you'd like to come, again, if you hadn't made it to the other ones that we've done, it'd still be good for you to come. You'll enjoy it. Been a blessing. We've had a great time there, great turnout for that. So that'll be Monday night, 7 o'clock. So come join us for that. And then this afternoon, you know we're having our fall festival. We'll be doing everything starting at about 4. We've got chili cook-off, face painting, games for kids. It's going to be a costume contest. We're going to have the bake sale and all that stuff's going to take off. We've got it all lined up. We're going to start the chili cook-off judging at 4:30. We're going to eat at 5, have the games from 5 to 6:30, and the auction's going to start at about 6. So bring some stuff. If you want to come, bring some desserts to eat. Bring some desserts to sell. If it's not dessert, you bring it. I got to clear something up. I sold a 50-cent piece 2 years ago. And I've been saying that I sold it for $40. And I thought that was really impressive. The video resurfaced of when I sold the coin on Facebook this week. I actually sold that 50-cent piece for $400. Oh. Yeah. So, bring all you 50-cent pieces tonight. We're going to build a new church. Amen. So, we're going to make it happen, Captain. So anyway, we have a lot of fun. So come and join in for that. All the stuff that we do in the auction and the fundraiser goes to the youth, and that supports their activities. Youth, junior youth, that supports what they do all year long. So it's a blessing, and our church always supports that. It's a great time, and we're looking forward to that. Plus, you'll go home with some really cool stuff and some good eats. So that'll be a blessing. The Young at Heart Sunday School class is having a Cajun supper at the church November 6th, Saturday night at 5:30 in the Fellowship Hall. So anybody in that class would like to come be a part of that, they're going to have a big time there. And I want to remind you of this. I skipped this while I was going through here. Is we're redoing the prayer list. If you have a prayer request that's on our current prayer list that needs to be left on the prayer list, write it down on the list in the foyer so that we won't take it off, because we're fixing to revamp the prayer list because we've got so many names that we're not getting any response to on Wednesday nights. A lot of people don't know when they were put on or what's going on with them. And if something gets taken off that you'd like to be added back, let us know. We'll get it right back on there. So we want to be praying for those who need to be praying for, but we also want to rejoice over those we can take off. So looking forward to that. Any other announcement before we pray? Thing we overlooked. Y'all ready for church?
Amen.
Let's pray. Father, we love you. We thank you today for the privilege we have to come into your house, Lord, to be able to sing praises, to bring and to receive a message from your word. Lord, through it all, we're here today to worship Jesus. So I pray today you be magnified, you be lifted up in this place. We pray your will be done. We pray, God, that our hearts would be touched and that you would speak in power. And Lord, we pray that if there's one among us, Lord, or if there's many here today that maybe don't know Christ as their Savior, they might be saved today. We pray, Lord, that you just work. Holy Spirit, have freedom in this place to do what you will and do what you please, and help us to have the ability to hear, to receive, to respond, and to obey what it is that you tell us to do. Lord, this is your day. Help us to approach this next part of this service. Lord, as we sing and as we preach and as we listen and respond, help us to do this as if we recognize today this is your house, this is your day, this is your word, and we're your people. Have your way today. We'll thank you for it. In Jesus' name, amen. church. People had asked about children's church. Miss Lisa's got children's church. We do that right after this. So anybody that's going to children's church is welcome to join her at this time. Amen.
What do y'all think about this choir over here?
Yep.
Do they look good? All right, this is one that a lot of you may not have heard before, but sorry, I'm trying to do this too many things here one time. This is an old song that I used to sing as a kid, and whenever I mentioned it to Tiffany, she said she did too, which means it's a really old song. But I know y'all know this. Y'all sing with us. We sing Joy Unspeakable.
Joy unspeakable and full of glory.
disappear. Oh, let me tell you about my Jesus and all the wrong turns that you would go and undo if you could. He can work it out for your good. Let me tell you about my Jesus. He makes a way where there ain't no way. Rises up from an empty grave. Ain't no sinner that he can't save. Let me tell you about my Jesus. His love is strong and his grace is free. And the good news is I know that he can do for you what he's done for me.
It's your breath in our lungs. Amen. Thank you so much. Are y'all enjoying Brother Ross and Miss Tiffany and some of the things they've been doing? Aren't they a blessing? Amen. Brother Stan, when he's not having to work, he's a blessing, an asset. Of course, we got the best band in the business. Amen. Amen. And amen. Our choir, he's talking about a good looking, but that back row wasn't too hot, but the rest of them looked real nice. If you have your Bibles, open with me, book of Revelation in chapter 20. We're going to read a verse from here and take off with somewhat of a topical type of a message, something that's been on my heart for several weeks. I have heard this expression all my life about preachers being what they would call hellfire and brimstone preachers. Y'all heard that expression, I'm sure. But oftentimes that was really more to do with the style of preaching than necessarily the subject, even though many would preach on hell. It was not necessarily that. They just thought that the old stomp and slobber and snort type preaching was what they would call hellfire and brimstone. And I've been in church a long time. I've heard of many great preachers. I've heard some outstanding evangelists in my time. And I've heard a lot of messages on these subjects and these passages that we'll be looking at today. And I'll be honest with you. I think one of the things that's hard to do is to preach this and not sound like you're mad. And one of my heart's burdens has been is to preach this with a heart of love today. And it's not that I think anybody's mad when they preach it. I think it's the warfare that you go through when you know this is what you're preaching. It really puts you on edge. It's amazing how you really experience the enemy when you preach. It's almost like you're on a coming onto his home turf and poking the bear, so to speak. And so I appreciate your prayers this morning as we look at this subject and as we preach today. I thought it was very interesting that, and I can't remember, I know it has, obviously, ever so many years, it has to happen that Sunday falls on Halloween, October 31st, which you know the origin of Halloween is not near about what we've made it in our culture, which is candy and fun and costumes and picking, but it is probably as close to the devil's holiday as there is as far as its origin is concerned. And so I just thought it quite entertaining to be able to kick the devil in the teeth this morning on the Lord's Day. Just because it's October 31st. Amen. And so we celebrate the goodness of the Lord today. So if you found it, stand with us. Revelation chapter 20. We're just going to read one verse kind of as a launching point, and we're going to make a big circle and come right back to here before we close. The Bible says in verse 15, "Whosoever was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire." I want to preach a message to you this morning as we look at the subject of hell, and I want to title the message that judgment is no trick and hell is no treat. Father, we ask you this morning in Jesus' name, just invade this place and do what you came to do. Take over, move me out of the way. Lord, give me unction and the spirit to be able to say and do what would be pleasing to you as you've laid this on my heart. Lord, we've prayed the prayers, we've studied, we've put together the message, we've done everything we can. And now it's between you and the heart and the ear of the receiver. And I pray today, God, that you would just come through and drown out every noise that the enemy might give us, the things that are in our mind and our heart that would cause us to be distracted from our lives and from this world. Let us focus today on what your word says. Lord, we're not here today to use scare tactics. We're not here today to say something somebody doesn't want to hear. We're here today just to talk about truth. So I pray today that your truth would set us free. I pray today that you be the victor in this place and that we get to enjoy the spoils of your victory. Have your way in this place today. Jesus be glorified. Lord, if we can't preach after a song service like that, then we ought to hang up our license. I pray today, Lord, that you just move and we'll thank you and praise you for it. In Jesus' name, amen. 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 Hell is mentioned in the Bible 32 times. Now, it's referenced 162 times in Scripture, and not one time will you find hell discussed or described in the Bible in a soft or playful way. There's not one instance in which hell is referred to lightly. Every time you find hell referenced or mentioned in Scripture, it's with great force and great clarity. Psalm 9:17 says that all the wicked shall be turned into hell, and every nation that forgets God. When we hear verses like that, I believe you would agree with me in your reading. When you come across these verses, they grab you. And the sobriety, the soberness of the verse really does something to our heart. There are some facts that I'd like to share with you about hell as we get into the message this morning. One, I want you to know this. If many churches, even denominations, have taken away things like this. I even heard, I don't know if some of you old hymn singers remember the verse that we sang this morning where the Bible says that, you know, there's a line in there and you could almost see with Brother Ross and Miss Tiffany in the place where there's at the cross where I first saw the light. There's a line in there that used to say, "And such a worm as I," and now it says, "Sinner such as I." We've tried to soften that up, but I've said this preaching before. You can call somebody a worm, and it really, if you know the Bible, is not worse than calling them a sinner. And so you think about how we've done through the ages and through the years, we've tried to take some of the sting away from preaching. And a lot of that is to please people and to draw crowds. And of course, we love people and we want crowds. Amen. But we have to tell those people the truth. We have to preach the truth to the Word of God. And I say this as an example of the number one greatest preacher who ever lived, Jesus Christ. He taught the majority of biblical truth on hell. Not of all the Old Testament and all the New Testament, the biggest portion of the teaching of the doctrine of hell is taught in the Gospels by Jesus Christ himself. Some 70 times Jesus shares in the Gospels, and he uses words like this. He said in Matthew 13 that this place that we call hell is a place that's wailing and gnashing of teeth. In Matthew 25, verse 41, he calls it an everlasting fire. In Mark chapter 9, verse 42 through 50, he would say three times that this is a place where their worm dieth not. He would say six times in a discussion of hell that it was fire. He would say six more times that it was never, or that it was not quenched, that there would be no relief, there would be no pulling back from this fire. But listen to what he also says in Matthew chapter 25, verse 41. The Bible says in Matthew 25, verse 41, Jesus says that this is an everlasting fire, but he says that it's prepared for the devil and his angels. That hell is a prepared place. It was a place that Jesus himself created, but not a place that was intended for people to go. A place that was created for the devil and for those who would follow in his rebellion and be cast out. We've heard them as fallen angels, demons, that would be cast into this place of torment or this place of punishment one day at the judgment. Now you understand in Scripture we learn about the judgment. We learn about eternal abodes. We opened with the song today, "When We All Get to Heaven." I want you to understand that is a song that's sung by redeemed people. That is not a song that's to be sung universally. That's not a song that lost people can join hands with us and sing. That's not a song that the heathen can sing with us. That's not a song that we can celebrate as a global unit. That is a song that's reserved for those who have been saved. Because you understand that there is a very strong numerical possibility that we in this room today could not truthfully all sing when we all get to heaven. That there would be some in here today that maybe we can sing it because we like the melody, or maybe we can sing it because we like the sentiment, but because of the truth of the fact that you have never been saved, there are some in here today that did, as Adrian Rogers said one time, we can sing a lie as well as we can tell one. And sometimes we can say things because they feel good. They make us feel good. But the reality is, unless you've been born again, unless you've been saved by the power of God and converted by the message of the gospel, then you're in bad, bad trouble this morning. As we consider this place called hell, there's two passages of Scripture that we know, passages we've preached before, passages you've heard, but passages that we're almost drawn to like a magnet when it comes to this subject. Passages that speak so profoundly of this place, this destination, that we can't help but go back to these places time and again. And one of those is in Luke chapter 16, verse 19 through 31. And I want to just draw three very simple truths from this passage, things that we've never noticed before, or maybe noticed but not preached as we've looked at this passage, but I'd like to read the entirety of this passage to you as we go through the message. There was a certain man, the Bible says, Luke 16, 19, that was rich. He was clothed in purple and fine linen and fared sumptuously every day. And there was a certain beggar named Lazarus that was laid at his gate full of sores, and desiring to be fed with the crumbs which fell from the rich man's table. Moreover, the dogs came and licked his sores. And it came to pass that the beggar died, catch this now, and was carried by the angels into Abraham's bosom. This was the understanding of paradise, the abode of the redeemed. The Bible says the rich man also died, and he was buried. And in hell, he lift up his eyes, being in torments, and sees Abraham afar off and Lazarus in his bosom. Lazarus in the comfort and the affection, the place of peace with the Lord. He cried and he said, Father Abraham, have mercy on me and send Lazarus that he may dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue, for I am tormented in this flame. But Abraham said, Son, remember that in thy lifetime thou receivest thy good things, and likewise Lazarus evil things, but now he's comforted and thou art tormented. Beside this, between you there is a great gulf fixed, that they which would pass from you or pass from here to you cannot, and those that would pass from you to us also cannot. There's no way to come between those two places. The Bible says, verse 27, then he said, I pray thee, Father Abraham, that you would send him to my father's house, for I have five brethren, that they may testify, or he may testify to them, that they also not come into this place of torment. And Abraham said unto him, they have Moses and the prophets. What he's saying is, they have the word of God. Let them hear them. And he said, no, Father Abraham, but if one went to them from the dead, they would repent. And he said, if they don't hear Moses and the prophets, then neither will they be persuaded, though one rose from the dead. There's no miracle that's going to change your heart. There's no miracle that's going to change your life. You're going to be changed by the truth of the gospel of Jesus Christ, or you're not going to be saved. That's what he was saying. Three times he uses the word torment in describing this place. So it's worth noting today that hell is a place of torment. It's a place of punishment. Hell is a place of separation. He wanted to know, could he send Lazarus? It's funny that the rich man's attitude towards Lazarus, who had been laid at his gate in his lifetime full of sores to give him opportunity to minister to his needs and to help him, yet it was Lazarus who laid at his gate full of sores, didn't ask for the food from the table, but begged for the crumbs which fell from the table. You've heard me preach this before. I believe that there's an implication here that the rich man released dogs to deter Lazarus from his gate, and the dogs showed him more compassion than even the rich man did. The Bible says they both died, and Lazarus is in heaven or paradise, and this rich man is in hell or in Hades, and he looks across this separation and he sees him, and it's amazing that his powerful nature and his attitude toward Lazarus was still that he ought to do what I tell him to do. So he says, tell Lazarus to come as a servant, as a slave. Tell Lazarus to come and do what I need him to do. Bring me water and touch my tongue and cool. Just a little drop of lukewarm water on my tongue would settle this torment, would help me bring some relief. And God says to him, it's not going to happen because there's a great gulf that's fixed between you. And the gulf is there to separate the light from the darkness, Hades from paradise, hell from heaven. And it's given in such a way that there's no way that anyone could pass this either direction, because there would be those in heaven who wanted to help those in hell. Those are the people that are in heaven because they have that same attitude as saved people on this earth. They wanted to help people and love people and minister to people. Even Paul said, I would die and go to hell if Israel could be saved. Their desire would be to go and to help, go and bring water, go and bring relief. But there's nothing for those people because it's an eternal destination. This place of separation would be that the light would be so bright in glory that no one in paradise could see into Hades. But in the darkness, surely you know, if you've ever been around a campfire, you could see into the light. And as they would look in the light, they would see people who they knew, people who they loved, people who they mistreated, people who they needed, but had no way to communicate with those people and no way to go to them or have them come to them. Hell is a place of torment. It's a place of separation, but it's also a place of finality. What a sobering truth when the rich man then says, all right, if he can't come to me because this gulf that's fixed, then send him back to earth. Let him go to my father's house. Funny how all of a sudden he's a minister. All of a sudden he's praying. There have been sermons preached out of this passage about things in hell that we need in every church. A heart for the lost. A desire to pray, an eye toward heaven. I mean, there's things you can see here. He wants Lazarus now to go and be returned to his father's house so that he can go testify to them about heaven and testify to them about hell. And he said, if he goes and does that, then they'll repent. They won't come to this place. And God said, that's not true, because miracles are not going to save you. Miracles are not going to change you. You've heard stories all your life about water being turned to wine, about blind people being healed, not just in the Bible, but there have been blind people healed. There have been lame people healed. There have been cancer people healed that we've known of, that God has touched with his own hand and healed their bodies. That didn't save anybody. Jesus didn't have to go to the cross to cure the common cold. He didn't have to go to the cross to take care of our coronavirus issues. Jesus had to go to the cross for one sickness and one disease only, and that was the sickness and the disease of sin. So he said, it's not going to work. If Lazarus even rises from the dead, they'll only be impressed by the miracle, but they will not hear the message. They have Moses and the prophets. Let them hear them. He would say to us today, we have the gospel. I can't help but think when you consider that there are degrees of punishment and degrees of responsibility when it comes to the eternal realm. I think about this rich man and how he died and went to hell having heard the gospel. I can't help but wonder today, as we preached several weeks ago, to whom much is given, much is required. How much hotter will the fire be for those who've heard this book? How much hotter will the fire be for those of you who own one of these books? For those who have read Scripture every day, who've heard messages every Sunday and die without Christ, how much more desperate of an agony will it be in hell for those who knew, as we understand hell to be a place where memories will not be erased, but a place where you will sit in torment forever and consider those who loved you, those who preached to you, those who offered you the gospel invitation to be saved and to be delivered from this fire. Mind you, a very literal fire, not a figurative fire, as many denominations have watered it down. And I find it funny that the preachers that water this down are the same preachers that'll go to the bar and drink a beer with their church members. The same preachers that'll water this down and preach against the doctrinal head are the same preachers that get in trouble for not keeping their hands to themselves, are the same preachers that call themselves right and whole and then are found with choir boys and altar boys in the back room. This is a literal place, and it's a place that's no respecter of person. There will be preacher and pastor and priest that burn in hell forever because they were not saved, because there's no amount of preaching and there's no amount of living and there's no amount of good that you can do that'll help you escape this place, because you're a sinner, and I'm a sinner. The Bible says that he tells them they have the Word of God, and if they don't hear the Word of God, they will not be persuaded. It doesn't matter how good I preach or how good we sing or how nice the building, or it doesn't matter how loud we shout or how high we jump or how fast we run. We're not going to persuade anybody who doesn't hear the message of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And for us to think that perhaps because we've got a good singing or good-looking preacher, amen, or because there's money in the bank or a wonderful facility, to assume that we have more of the power of God to convert the sinner than the small wood frame church with an old piano and pipe organ and somebody that doesn't know how to come here from Sikkim. The power of God is the gospel of Jesus Christ, plus nothing, minus nothing. He does not need what we have or what we bring to the table, because what we have and bring to the table has been proven invalid or incapable of saving the soul. The gospel of Jesus Christ. Some of the most powerful churches on the world today are meeting under trees and bushes on the other side of this world today. And they've got the power of God on them because they've learned not to lean on some of the things that we've called modern conveniences and things that we trust today. This place called hell that we read about in Luke chapter 16, again, is this holding place called Hades. This place across the Gulf was paradise. These two places where people would be held. When you study the gospel of Jesus Christ, you'll find that there was a resurrection when Jesus Christ came out of the grave, and those who were in paradise, those souls who the Bible talks about, were being kept in waiting, that those were delivered from paradise and they would ascend into heaven, be resurrected and brought to heaven. And hell hath enlarged herself and expended herself, because again, she was not built to hold men and women, but to hold the devil and his angels. And because we choose to die in our sin, we have to go there as well. So those who are in hell today are still in hell today. They're in Hades today, awaiting what will be considered the final judgment. The Bible describes this final judgment as the great white throne judgment. In Revelation chapter 20, in the text that we used, the verses leading up to this are very incredible when you consider the magnitude of what it is that's being said and who it is that's being said to. Now, there are two judgments that'll conclude the entire human race. The judgment seat of Christ, which Paul would talk about to the Corinthian churches. There was actually what they called a judgment seat in Corinth, as he would tell the Corinthians. And many of you know we've been studying in the book of Acts, and we talked about Corinth, that he would use this as an illustration that you will all stand before the judgment seat of Christ, that we'll receive the things that were done in this body, that we'll have to give an account for every idle word that's spoken, everything that we've done, everywhere that we've gone, what we've done with opportunities, the things we've said yes to, the things we've said no to. We stand before God in judgment. The good news at the judgment seat of Christ is that we stand before God with an advocate. a representative. We have one that's there to represent us, and that's Jesus Christ. I think there's going to be some things revealed at the judgment seat that we've not preached enough, and that is, I think that all of our sin is going to be revealed, and in contrast to all of our goodness, it's going to show us that there's not enough goodness that we could have ever done to be saved or to deserve to be at the judgment seat of Christ. It's only the blood of Jesus that will allow us to be in that position. But under the blood of the Lord Jesus, we go to the judgment seat of Christ, not to be judged with a judgment of condemnation, but to be judged with a judgment somewhat of inventory, where God will take the bad things that we did and show us where we failed. God will take the good things that we did and reward those good things that Jesus was allowed to do in us, the performance in this life that we've done. You will be rewarded for the good things that you do. But the ultimate revelation at the judgment seat of Christ is that your bad was not bad enough to condemn you because you were saved, and your good was not good enough to save you. Jesus is the only reason that you're there. Amen. What a celebration that'll be at the judgment seat of Christ when I find out that my goodness, though it wasn't good enough, and my sin, though it may have seemed small in this life, was enough to send me to hell forever, that I was taken care of and covered in the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ, and I'm represented in the presence of God, the judgment seat of Christ. Then in Revelation 20, the great white throne judgment. John would write in verse 11, "And I saw a great white throne, and him that sat on it, from whose face the earth and the heaven fled away, and there was found no place for them. And I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God, and the books were opened. And another book was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged out of those things which were written in the books, according to their works. And the sea gave up the dead which were in it, and death and hell delivered up the dead which were in them, and they were judged, every man according to their works. And death and hell were cast into the lake of fire." This is the second death. "And whosoever was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire." The Bible says in Hebrews chapter 9 that it's appointed unto man once to die, and after that the judgment. So you're going to die and you're going to stand before God. And where you stand before God at judgment seat or the great white throne is going to be determined by where you stand with God in this life. Those who go to the great white throne, the Bible says, will die what the Bible calls a second death. Understand, according to Hebrews chapter 9, it's only been appointed unto man once to die. That means there's only one death that's required of you. The Bible teaches us in Romans chapter 6 and verse 23 that the wages of sin is death. But the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. At Lazarus' tomb, Jesus would say to Mary and Martha, "Whosoever liveth and believeth on me shall never die. Believest thou this?" The reality is this body is going to fall asleep one day. This body is going to be laid to rest, but Reuben gets to live forever. I've been born again by the Spirit of God. You've heard this saying, and it's a mathematical equation according to Scripture, but if you're born twice, you only die once. A physical death. If you're born physically of your mother, if you're born spiritually of the Lord, then you only die once, a physical death. But if you're only born physically, then you're going to die physically, and then you're going to die spiritually. That's the second death described here at the great white throne judgment. He says that whosoever's name was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. He talks about it, this thing. Understand, this is going to be a just judgment. This is not going to be biased. I don't know how many of you watch ball and you get mad. We've been playing football and we've been watching some football and you see the referees and boy, everybody gives it to the refs, right? Because there's always seems to be some kind of bias. There seems to be some kind of slant. I heard a story about a great baseball manager for the New York Yankees that said he had a dream one time and he went to heaven and he got to heaven and he looked around and all the greats were there. Babe Ruth, Ty Cobb, all the great baseball players were there. And he said while he was rejoicing and celebrating with all the great ball players of old that the phone rang and it was the devil. And he said, "I want to challenge you to a baseball game." And he said, "Man, y'all are in trouble." He said, "Why?" He said, "Because we got all the players." The devil said, "Yeah, but we got all the umpires." You understand there won't be any home cooking at the great white throne. There won't be any bias at the great white throne, only truth. The Bible said the books will be open, 66 books of the Bible. Why would God judge us from anything other than what we have the opportunity to hold in our hand and live by? The 66 books of the Bible, which would conclude your name being written in the book of life. For those who have been saved by the grace of God, born again by the grace and the power of God, your name has been written in inerasable or unerasable ink, perhaps even the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ, been written in a book called the Book of Life. It'll never be erased, never be taken away. You are there, and you are there eternally. And the Bible says that whosoever's name is not found written in that book of life be cast to the lake of fire. He said that everybody would be judged according to their works. Understand, you catch that, because the Bible says, Ephesians chapter 2 and verse 8 and 9, for by grace are you saved through faith, not of yourself, it's a gift of God, not of works, lest any man boast. So no matter how great your works are, no matter how many wonderful things you've done, if you've not stood in a pool of blood and confessed yourself a sinner, repented of your sins, and believed on Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, you're going to hell. Whosoever's name was not found written in that book of life, he didn't care about the agony. He didn't care about the discussions. You would even read in Matthew 7, there were people who said, Lord, we preached, we did miracles, we did wonderful works in your name. And you know what Jesus would say to them? Depart from me, because I never knew you. This crowd trying to discuss with Jesus, trying to argue with the judge what it is that's going on, but there's no room for emotion. There's no room for compassion. There's no more room for grace. There's no more room for mercy. All those people that were there, the Bible said the fury of the face of our Lord was so stout that the heaven and earth fled away. Now there's no place for those people. And they stand in judgment. These are those who have been held in this place called hell. These are those who have died and been delivered. Those who were dead at sea have been delivered. And all the dead who died without Christ are now standing at this great white throne. And John would even say, I saw small and great. He means I saw great in stature. There were preachers and presidents and kings and rulers who died without Christ. Perhaps even Agrippa, who the Bible said to Paul, would make this statement, that you almost persuade me to be a Christian. Felix, the Bible said, would tremble and say to Paul, I'm going to send for you in a more convenient season. And that convenient season never came. These rulers, these leaders, would stand before God at the great white throne of judgment, and they would not be allowed to be compared. They were not allowed to be scored or to be changed. They're looking at them factually. They're judged according to their works, which the Bible says are not sufficient to salvation. And then, according to the things that were written in the book of life, he would go down this list of names, not to have an argument or a debate. He's not doing anything to cast personal bias or judgment on them or prejudice whatsoever, but to show them in the book that your name's either here or it's not. And that's the only thing that's going to decide what happens at the great white throne. And if your name is there, then you're already taken care of. You're not even at the great white throne, but all of those who are at the great white throne, their name was not written in the book of life because they rejected the gospel of Jesus Christ and they died in their sin. And they were cast, the Bible said, in the lake of fire. And the word study would say that cast is as one carelessly tosses a stone. Without any remorse, without any compassion, God would cast those who died without his son into the lake of fire because it was their sin, just like mine, that sent our precious Lord to the cross of Calvary. To die a death that he didn't deserve. And they would reject such a free salvation. But it brings a whole new appreciation to verses like John 3:16, doesn't it? For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. The hymnist would later write, whosoever surely meaneth me, surely meaneth me, oh, surely meaneth me. Verses like John 3:3 were. Jesus would look at Nicodemus, a great religious leader, a great man of faith, a man of Jewish royalty, if you will, in the religious sect, a ruler of the Jews, a man with political stroke, a man who, when he walked in the synagogue, the other Pharisees got out of the way. That's Brother Nicodemus walking in the house, perhaps Dr. Nicodemus. Jesus would look at Nicodemus and all of his religion and all of his credentials and say to Nicodemus, except a man be born again. He can't see the kingdom of God. The justice at the great white throne, in contrast to 1 John 1:9, where the Bible says, if we'll confess our sin, he's faithful and just, legal, orderly, right, to forgive our sin and cleanse us from all of our unrighteousness. There is a legal way, a just way, a right way for you to be saved today. The Bible would go on in Scripture to say things like Romans 10:13, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. The message today gives us an idea of what it is we're being saved from. We get lost sometimes in the melody of the songs that we sing. It's agonizing as a preacher of the gospel to know that you've got the truth that'll help somebody and never be able to figure out why or how somebody can know that and walk away unsaved and unchanged. And to know that one day, maybe Brother David and others who've taught and sang and spoke before people that we love and care for, that there'll be people standing at that great white throne remembering messages like this, remembering opportunities like today. When I think about people that I've preached to dying and going to hell, it haunts me. Because as much as I want you to be fed when we meet, and as much as I want you to have joy and peace, and as much as I want you to have a good marriage and have good finances and have a good home and have happiness and peace, I want you to know that you're going to heaven, and I want to know that I'm going to see you there. And I couldn't care less about all that other stuff if you first don't know that you've been saved. And I think about places I've preached and things that I've done and opportunities I've had and people that would hear the gospel and walk away from that. But I'm going to tell you like this. I love my kids more than I love your kids. Is that fair? Yep. You do the same. Well, I love my church. And I love my community. And I love this home more than I love any other church or any other community. And I love our church kids and our church family more than other church families because I'm the pastor of this church. And as much as I'd hate to see an absolute stranger go to hell, it breaks my heart to think about people we've spent all these wonderful times with. So here's the invitation. Don't go to hell. Because you don't have to. Because Jesus Christ took the wrath of God on the cross of Calvary, and he died for your sin to give us this opportunity to be saved. I've been saved, and I'm so thankful. And life gets tough, and there are so many challenges, but I know that I'm going to heaven, and there won't be no more trouble there. And I hope you know that too. But if you don't, won't you be saved today? What a Halloween. Let's kick the tricks and the treats out the door, and let's just get right with the truth today. Be saved before it's too late. Stand with me. Father, I love you. God, you know this week the burden. And God, I feel so heavy as we come now to the point that you almost fear as a preacher. The point that, Lord, we know you have an intention today to do something that's now out of our control. Lord, this is surely not the best we've ever heard, but it's the best I could do with it. But we've come to this place to give your invitation, and it's between you and the people. God, I pray anything I've said or done that might be distracting or discouraging would be erased from our minds and hearts, and we'd just be drawn to the truth of Scripture that there is a place called hell, and it awaits all of those who die without Christ. And there will be no excuse for us when we stand before God, because we have the gospel of Jesus Christ that will set us free today. So I pray today for one, or may there be many today, who need to be saved, that they would humble themselves and submit to the Spirit of God today, and they would trust Christ as their Lord and Savior and be forever saved. We'll thank you for it. In Jesus' name, amen.